Good afternoon. How's everybody doing? Good? Awesome. My name is Maria Lopez Strong, and I'm the diversity coordinator and career counselor. I work over on 34th and Avenue Q. So if you're trying to find classes or need somebody to talk to, please call me. I want to talk to you a little bit about Simon Silva. Christy Martinez with the Latino magazine. How many of you have seen that magazine? It's a nice magazine, right? So she called me about Simon and saying that he was here in Lubbock for a presentation that he's doing for Region 17 and for the community of Lubbock. And I thought this would be such a good opportunity for students to hear what he has to offer, because, you know, we get people that come to Lubbock and they make presentations, but they kind of don't venture out to our area. And so this is such a good opportunity for all of us to learn something new and to see good artwork and to hear such a wonderful man talk about his art and the love of creating and how the mind works. So let me just tell you a little bit about him. First of all, it's a privilege to have you here, Simon. Thank you for being here. Simon is a creativity crusader, author and speaker, and has been for many years. He has collectors throughout the world. He's from California, and he lives with his wife and his three sons. He travels extensively all the time, and his presentations include, like I said earlier, to Region 17, to people everywhere, and he shows his artwork. And of course, that includes educators, so we're very, very excited today. He knows firsthand the importance of a good education, because he is the first of 11 children out of his family to go to high school and graduate from high school, go to college and graduate from college. He earned and paid his college tuition through his artistic talents. He graduated from the prestigious School of Art, the Art Center College of Design in California, with a four-year degree. Simon was born to parents that are farmers, and his family is mainly of farmers. He grew up as a migrant student, and he relied heavily on his artistic skills to help him cope with difficult times. And I know that sometimes as students, and you know, a long time ago I used to be a student, the things that we do to cope through difficult times, they vary. Okay, so maybe today he'll impart some of those things that he used to cope, coping mechanisms, and he'll share that with us. He was also born in Mexicali, Mexico, and he came to us when he was, or to the U.S., the United States, when he was 1 year old. As I mentioned earlier, he speaks to educators and students and people everywhere. Let's show him what a West Texas welcome is like. Thank you for being here. Come on up.
All right, good afternoon. You guys okay? We'll try it in Spanish. Buenas tardes. All right, so much better. Thank you, Maria, for that introduction. It's good to be here. I'm a byproduct of a community college, so for whatever reason you have chosen to come to this institution, the community college, you have done the right thing, trust me. If you're serious about your education, I think community colleges offer you the best bang for your buck. And I think the name of the game now is to receive your degree owing the least amount of, having the least amount of debt possible. So I've been a big advocate of community colleges because of what they can offer you for the price, which is a great deal. I'm here this afternoon. I will speak for approximately 45 minutes to an hour, and the best part of doing these kinds of presentations is to give you an opportunity to pick my brain and ask me some questions. Put me on the spot. You can ask me anything you want. You're not going to embarrass me much, I think. So I'm going to specifically also share a little bit about my life, because I think that's important. And I'm only going to share that because I believe I'm an example of what I'm trying to share with you guys in terms of the information of creativity and the importance of creativity. So I'm a good example. I don't think that I'm the example, but I'm a good example of what I'm talking about here this afternoon. So what I do want to start with, I want to start off with a couple of the websites that I have currently on the internet. So if you're interested in the future, contacting me, asking me questions, sending me your artwork or stories for a critique, I will do that for you. Unfortunately, we have this wonderful thing called the internet, and the average person uses the internet for sheer entertainment purposes. You can get a world-class education from the internet, which is amazing, right? Not pay a single penny, but yet get a world-class education. You can do that. We have to use the internet correctly. It's just a tool. That's all it is. It's a tool. I do have two websites. I have the art websites, which you're seeing now, and I have the speaking website. So if you want to share these websites with friends, family, again, I'm open to receiving artwork, which I do on occasion. Students will share their artwork with me, and I will give them a very honest critique, if you know what I mean, right? So if you cry easily, maybe not send me your stuff, right? But I will give you an honest critique. And more importantly, I just want to urge all of you guys to reach out to people on the internet. You know, people whose lives and whose work you admire. No matter how crazy the idea or how famous they are, you know, you should reach out to them. The worst thing that could happen is they ignore you. Best thing that can happen, you get some wonderful free information, right? I'll give you guys a good example. About 6 months ago, I saw this wonderful, amazing YouTube video. Actually, it was a TED Talk on YouTube. Isabel Allende, the American Chilean-American author, who my wife and I are huge fans of her work. After I saw a video on growing old creatively, I was so impressed with her presentation that I had to reach out and I sent her an email. And I said, Isabel, I loved your presentation. I learned a lot from it, and I just wanted to say thank you. A couple of days later, I got this wonderful email from Isabel. She said, Simon, thank you for your kind words. Please send me your mailing address because I want to send your wife and you a gift. About a week later, sure enough, she sent a signed copy of her latest novel for my wife and I. Now, am I saying that if you reach out to Isabel, she's going to send you a book as well? I don't know. You're never going to find out unless you actually do what? Do it. Try it, okay? Not just Isabel, but, and not even me. I mean, you should reach out for anybody and everybody whose life or whose work you admire, right? One thing that I know for sure, guys, in my own life, in the 55 years of, you know, my life, is that there's always been individuals who want to be part of a success story. I want to be part of that. But there's an obligation on your behalf, the obligation that you need to show people that you want to succeed, right? That you're trying the best that you can, and people will honor that. When I went to school, people found out about my story, and they gave me money, they gave me a place to sleep, they gave me materials, supplies, and more importantly, they gave me some wonderful advice to keep going because I really wanted to quit many, many times. So please, please, please do yourself a big, huge favor and reach out to as many people as you can. I'd say your odds are about 50-50, right? And the people that don't respond to your emails, they're probably not that important anyways, right? So that's a good thing. They're going to weed themselves out. When I was in high school, junior high, elementary school, the teacher would ask a question, and we had the same 5-6 people raise their hand and answer all those questions. Does that sound familiar to any of you? And after so many years of experiencing that, by the time I got to high school, boy, did I feel dumb. I really felt that these 5-6 guys, girls, were so much more intelligent than I was. Any of you here feel that way? Somehow maybe you're lesser than other people? Yeah. Well, I gotta tell you, man, that's how I felt. I felt that I was not that intelligent. And the issue wasn't that I was any less intelligent than these individuals. As a matter of fact, now that I look back, I'm probably smarter than all of them put together. Well, that's my ego talking, right? No, not that smart. But see, here's the thing, guys. The problem is that I didn't see the ocean until I was 17. I didn't experience snow until I was 20. And people laughed. I hadn't flown an airplane until I was 26. When many of us don't provide ourselves with a multitude of variable experiences, how are you going to be able to answer things if you don't even know they exist, or what it's about, or how they work? Without knowing anything about any of you guys, I can tell you for a fact that I can bet my life on the fact that each and every one of you are incredibly intelligent, incredibly creative. Now, you may not feel it, you may not believe it, but that's the truth, whether you believe it or not. And we're living in the best of times, and we're living in the worst of times. And I don't even have to explain myself on that one, right? We know what I'm talking about. And it's exciting because we have an opportunity to do something that the past hasn't done yet. But what I do want to do is I also want to start off by sharing with you the dynamics of what the arts are about. As I travel around the country and I ask students, literally ask them, even at some of the most prestigious colleges and universities around the country, how many of your parents are actually excited that you're declaring yourself to be an art major? As a matter of fact, how many of you are art majors here or thinking about majoring in art? Don't be embarrassed, guys. We're not going to. You're my team. I'm with you. No art majors. Wow. Well, maybe I can recruit a few this evening. So this is the website to the school that I went to. I went to the prestigious Art Center College of Design. I only went there because a couple of my friends went there, and I was terrified of going to college and moving out of my house. And I went there because a couple of my friends went there, and I figured, okay, I'm going to know two people, so that's a good thing. It's going to make it easier for me. That's the truth. Unfortunately, as I travel around and ask this question, specifically to parents, a lot of parents are super worried about the fact that their kids are going to be art majors and they're going to starve to death. And the simple fact is that it all boils down to ignorance. And the one thing that I want to say about ignorance, guys, is that we're all ignorant about many things, including myself. Now, Maria, she's really close to not being ignorant in anything, but you know, she's an exception, right? But we're all ignorant. But that's a good thing, right? Because ignorance is not bad. The only reason why ignorance is bad is when you don't do anything to do anything about that ignorance that you carry around, right? About things. So as I travel around the country and ask students, parents, about whether or not they're excited about being art majors, obviously I get about 10-15%. That's probably average. So what I want to do here is kind of disclose, right? If you go to the website, I think it's changed since I downloaded some of this stuff, but I want to share with you that some of the majors under the umbrella of the arts, right? For example, we have illustration, which is the major that I majored in. As an illustrator, you make a lot of money as an illustrator. Back in the table, you'll see a couple of children's books. I still get a check for about $2,000-$3,000 every 6 months, even though the book has been out for about 12 years. I didn't want to do illustration anymore because I didn't want to be told what to do, right? Drunken art directors from New York, you know, calling me at 1 o'clock in the morning, California time, right? So I basically decided that I didn't want to do illustration anymore, but I did stuff for Time Magazine. I'll show you some examples. Bon Appetit, LA Times Magazine, newspaper, all that stuff. CD covers, LP covers, those kinds of things. And you can do quite well with this. If you're looking for something a little more exciting, you can do transportation design. Some of the better designers out there are actually women. So ladies, we know that you drive faster than guys anyways, right? But you also get more tickets than guys, right? It's kind of the downfall of that. Boats, motorcycles, all that good stuff. Art Center is a good school for that. We also have product design. This clicker that I'm using, most people don't realize that a lot of the stuff they have in their own home falls into the category of product design, right? You don't actually have to know how this stuff works, the computer, this clicker, cell phone, glasses, tennis shoes, you know, those kinds of things, dog houses. All that stuff falls under the category of product design, coffee makers, you know, that kind of stuff, toasters. You also have graphic design. Unless you're actually the creme of the creme in graphic design, you're probably not going to be able to make a good living in graphic design. I would say that if you're interested in this, you're probably going to have to do a multitude of things. For example, illustration, maybe web page design as well, just to be on the safe side. You can also do environmental design, which is not interior design, something entirely different. You also have entertainment design, You have industrial design, which used to be part of product design. I don't know why they changed it, but we also have graphics packaging. If you go to the store and you buy something, pretty much everything comes in packages now. Even vegetables have that breathable material and stuff like that. So all of that stuff is jobs within the umbrella of the arts. We also have fine art. We have, what are they calling this? They're calling it media design. If you're watching a game, right, and you see the statistics of a player, the photograph, you know, kind of whooshes in and out of the screen, that falls under the category. And we also have photography. We have photography. We have medical illustration, art teachers, and the list kind of goes on and on and on. Advertising. Those guys make a lot of money, right? The commercials you see during the halftime of Super Bowl, those guys trying to sell you a product, stick of gum or a candy bar or even an automobile. Does anybody have any questions on those? Because I want to make sure that if I have any kind of knowledge in those areas, if you have any questions, I can answer those questions for you. But again, if you in the near future decide to become an art major, direct your parents' attention to the fact that you're not going to starve, that there's actually some legitimate jobs out there that are going to keep you alive, right? That's a good thing, okay? No questions on that. All right, for those of you who haven't gone into the internet and kind of explored who Simon Silva is, I used to be an artist. I'm calling myself a creativity crusader because I'm on a crusade to demystify the whole process of creativity, but also to remove the word art and artist from our vocabulary, because I believe that the word art and artist no longer suffices what an artist is about or what even art is about. People still kind of get weirded out about what art is and what it's not. And I still think there's a lot of confusion, and part of the confusion is made by the continuation of using the word art and artist, right? Prostitutes are no longer prostitutes, they're escorts, from what I hear. I was gonna do a presentation at a rest home, right? I grew up with the word rest home, right? Where the old people live, like me. My agent almost chopped my head off. She said, Simone, you cannot say rest home because people don't wanna be reminded that they're 6 months from 6 feet under, right? So I said, well, what do you call it? She says, well, you have to call them luxury adult living communities, right? You're not poor, you're financially challenged. I mean, everything has changed, right? Everything has changed. And yet we still continue to use the word art and artist, which I think is obsolete. It doesn't suffice what we need to address. So I was a former artist. Now I'm a creativity crusader, and this is some of the work that I've done. These are some of the current, couple of current commission pieces that I did for some of the collectors. I also did, like I said earlier, I did quite a bit of illustration for a number of years. Time Magazine, Newsweek, book covers, posters. As you can tell, there's a couple of designs for some buses here. One of them is vector, the other one is actually hand-painted. I did a series of things called, did a thing called Gotham Jazz. I'm a huge jazz lover, so I figured why not, right? Makes two of my favorite things, comic books and jazz, right? So Miles Davis becomes, you know, Batman, of course. Billie Holiday becomes the Catwoman and so forth and so forth. I've also done some vector files for my kids because I think it's important as a father to be able to relate some way, shape, or form to my kids. So we share music. I love music. That's a big, big thing that I do. And I'm a big collector of, you know, vintage LPs and things like that. So I did a whole series of hip-hop artists. On the left, yeah, on your left is Dame Funk. If you haven't listened to him, you should. We have the now deceased Shingo, New Jabez. We have, of course, Jay Dilla, and we have Dr. Yusef Lateef. And I actually reached out to Dr. Lateef before he died a couple of years ago, and I sent him a couple of prints of this, and he actually signed some of his stuff. And I gave one to my son, who was a huge fan of Yusef Lateef, Dr. Lateef. So I was like the dad of the year that particular year because I was able to connect with him, right? Because he signed it before he died. I've also written a couple of books. I did a couple of children's books. I did the illustration. The illustrations for these books I actually wrote and worked on El Campo and also Small Town Brownie, which is a collection of short stories. How did I know I could write? I didn't. I shared one of the stories that I wrote. I gave it to my wife to read. She said, who sent this to you? And I said, what do you mean, who sent this to me? I wrote it. She goes, I didn't know you could write. I said, I didn't know I could write either. So there, you know. You know, there's so many things that we can do. And unfortunately, because we've never tried it, we're never going to find out. We're actually really good at it, unfortunately. And about a year and a half ago, I came up with this particular book called Cultivate a Creative Mind. And it was, again, just to help people. It was a guide to help people regain their creativity that they've lost over the years. And now they're fearful of being super creative, which is unfortunate. This is a photograph of my youngest son, Emilio. And as you can tell, he's in my studio. And he's working on one of his masterpieces. And I do say that, you know, in a very honest, sincere fashion. It is a masterpiece, truly is. I had an open door policy. My kids could come into my studio anytime they wanted. And they did. And they would come in and they would draw and they would paint and we'd listen to music. And most of the time, what I would do is I would just put down my brush and I literally would just stand behind them just looking at them work, because I've been trained to work a certain way. There's a procedure that I do, right? I come up with the idea, do the composition, sketches and whatnot. My kids, even at a very young age, it was like magic. They were inspired. There's no sketches, no nothing, no hesitation, right into the production of the art piece. It was magical. It was beautiful. Well, one day, my oldest son comes in, and he's crying because he wants to paint like his dad. And that's not a good idea, because my kid's already a million times better than I am, even at 8 or 6 or 7. So he starts crying because he's trying to mix the same colors that I'm mixing on my palette. And I said, look, there's a problem here. There are no rules. And so what I did was I went to my art library. I took out the book of Vincent van Gogh, one of my all-time favorite artists, him and Cézanne, of course. And I opened up to this color plate of this portrait that he did of his mother. And I said, look, one of my favorite artists, he painted his mother green. Kind of spooky green, right? I don't know if I want to meet her in an alley, right? But, you know, green, right? So that's all I said. That's all I needed to say. And I've never given him an art lesson. That was as far as I took it. So he wiped away his tears, went back to his little easel, and with the theme of mothers, he decided to create one of his own mom at age 7, right? If you ever meet my wife, you'll see why I think my wife is hot. She's yellow, she's got huge red lips, she's got a huge green nose and green hair. Looks just like her. But truly, I mean, unfortunately, we as adults, we as parents, in many occasions are incapable of recognizing the genius before our eyes. And that's a huge problem, and I'll tell you why in a second. But let me tell you a little bit about how Simon Silva got to where he's at. Like Maria said, I'm originally from Mexicali, Mexico. I was only born there. My parents actually brought me when I was a year and a half. So I've been here for most of my life. That's why I have that California accent, in case you notice, right? We settled in the small town of Hopeville, California. This is a photograph when I was in second grade. I was actually kind of cute, right? Good looking. Then I got old. But don't laugh too hard, because it happens to everyone, I hear, right? I didn't even know what a toothbrush was. I mean, this is how poor we were. You know, we didn't have any food. We had a lot of food. We had food, but, you know, my diet consisted of eggs, potatoes, and beans. And I swore to myself that if I ever got rich and famous, that I was never going to eat beans, potatoes, and eggs ever again, right? Just filet mignon for me, right, from now on, right? And now as I travel around, I get back home, and my wife says, I don't have anything for dinner. What do you want me to make you? Make me some beans, some potatoes, and eggs. Now it's like comfort food for me, right? So never say never, guys. It'll come back and haunt you. So we settled in the small town of Hopeville, California. This is the entrance to my house. As you can tell, there's not much to look at, man. I was living on the wrong side of the tracks in the barrio. It was a two-bedroom, one-bath house. There was 13 of us in my family. That included my parents. I didn't have my own room, didn't have my own bed. I slept with two or three other brothers. Uno se meaba la noche, and I had to run out in the middle of the night, right? In the wintertime, it was kind of cool because you were warm for a couple hours, but then it kind of cooled off and wasn't that cool, right? See, you got the translation there. Unfortunately, I also grew up with my dad being an alcoholic, and because of his alcohol abuse, he would beat up my mom. And as a young kid, that terrified me. As a young adult, that embarrassed me, and as an adult, it would anger me. I went to school because I felt safer in school than I did in my own home. That's the truth. And I sat in the back of the class so no one would point me out. And I would think about this thing called future, right? What was it going to look like? Or what did I want it to look like? I think it was a better thing. So I made a list of things. I think it's important for you guys to have a goal, right? I mean, all your effort. What's your goal? What do you want? What do you need? And so I made a list of things that I wanted, things that I definitely needed. And sometimes I think that when we're confronted by these very difficult times, these ugly occasions, I think it's a good way to reverse it and turn a negative into a positive. All that fighting, all the ugliness, you know, the gunshots in my house in the middle of the night, walking across town at 3 o'clock in the morning, right? That proved to me, without a shadow of a doubt, that nonsense was not going to happen in my future. I knew that for a fact. So sometimes we can turn a negative into a positive if we know what to do. Unfortunately, I also grew up as a migrant student. For those of you who don't know what a migrant student is, basically that's what it looks like. This is Simon Silva, 16 years old, picking raspberries in the state of Oregon. We traveled up and down the state of California, as far north as Oregon and Washington State every summer. And I started working on the fields approximately when I was 6 years old. Totally illegal, but my parents still did it anyways. My father loved taking us out of school about a month early, came back about a month and a half late. He loved going to Washington State. Why? Well, because we found out that the sun doesn't set in Washington State during the summertime until like 10:30 at night. So he could literally work us until 6:30, 7:30, 8:30 at night, and we still had plenty of sunshine, just like this. He loved that. And he did. He worked us 7 days a week. And he worked us right into the new school year, and he was not a nice guy, let's put it that way. He was kind of a vicious tyrant, let's put it that way. Unfortunately, there was not much I could do other than just kind of, you know, use that time to kind of think about my future. If I was going to have a future, what did I want it to look like? Kind of make plans, right? I know I wanted a weenie dog, that's for sure. I wanted a weenie dog. I don't know why. I thought weenie dogs were crazy, you know, great. I wanted to marry a beautiful lady. I wanted a nice house, nice car. I wanted some money. Actually, no, wait a minute. I wanted a lot of money. The more, the better, right? But, you know, I would have traded all that stuff, all of it, for people just to look at me and say, wow, you know, that's not just another kid from the barrio, right? That's not just another Mexicano or Mexican-American. I wanted people to look at me and look at me as someone who had something to offer. I wanted people to respect me. That was important for me, very important. If you're looking for me in this photograph, I'm the guy with the Gilligan's Island hat picking green beans in the state of Salem, Oregon. Worst job I ever did. You can tell that my brother has his shoes off because the ground is basically soaking with water. And it was so hot and humid that it was actually much more pleasant to work without our shoes. My parents weren't big fans of education. My parents had a third grade education from Mexico. They didn't quite understand what education was about or what it was for. I mean, come on, let's think about this for a second. A lot of people in this country have not had the opportunity to develop their abstract thinking skills. And what do I mean by that? Well, to me, I think this whole process, this journey of education, right? We pay thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars. We go to school for, you know, 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12 years, or whatever it is to graduate now. And at the end of all these years, all this money that we pay, they give us this wonderful ceremony, and they give us this beautiful paper with our name on it. I don't know about you guys, but I think that it's a little bizarre if you don't look at it from an abstract way, right? That the education is really not in the paper, it's really in your head. My parents did not understand that. They hadn't worked on their abstract thinking skills, so they thought it was a waste of time. So by the time my brothers and sisters were in junior high and high school, they literally were yanked out. They were dragged out, they were pulled out, and that was it. They were gonna have to work in the fields for the rest of their life. I knew that that was something that I knew for sure I did not wanna do. I knew that. I mean, those times were terrible. So I did the next best thing that I could do. I asked my mother to do my dirty work for me, right? Because that's how we do it as macho men, right? We put it on my mom's lap and say, you take care of it. Her job was to convince my father to let me go to college. And she approached my dad, unfortunately my dad here with one of his famous roosters. He was a gallero. We had about 200 of these things in the backyard. I absolutely hated these animals. He spent more time with them. He gave them a special diet, special exercise, special everything. My father responded to my mom's request on my behalf, turning violent. He wanted to beat us both up. He was dead set that nobody was going to go to college. He called us a whole bunch of bad words, both in English, Spanish, and I think it was Chinese, because every time he got drunk, he became completely trilingual. Kind of a beautiful thing. It was like magic, right? I think he was working on his German with tequila shots, I think. And he wanted to kick us out of the house. I mean, he was so disgusted by that request. Luckily for me, I know better than to confront an angry mom, let alone an angry Latina mom. Because Latina moms, there was a time period where they started cutting things off. Look into it. It's on the internet. Look at Lorena Bobbitt, right? That's all I'm going to say. So you don't mess with angry Latina moms. Stuff happens. They're crazy in a good way. My mom got together with my two aunts. They formed their own little wise woman club. You can call it a gang. Yeah. And they approached my dad, and they literally forced him to let me go to college. And I'm still the only one of 11 kids to go off to college and graduate. I had no idea what this journey was about. I had no idea what to expect. It was scary. So I decided that I was going to stick close to home. I went to the Imperial Valley College for 2 years. I had no idea what I wanted to major in. This is pre-internet, guys, right? And basically, I decided to become an art major only because I felt that it was the safest thing for me to get into. And after 2 years, I ended up transferring to the Art Center College of Design. No, this is not Richard Ramirez, the serial killer. This is actually Simon Silva 1.0. Somebody asked me that question. I'm like, come on, really? I mean, I did the best that I could, right? I mean, I had really bad hair. There was no gel. This is pre-gel. If you look into this young man's eyes, you can see how terrified this kid is, right? Coming from a town of 3,000 people to LA, basically, I was terrified. I can honestly tell you, in all honesty, that the first 2 or 3 months, I cried. Yeah, I cried a lot. I screamed, I yelled. But again, I want to point out to you guys this beautiful thing that happens in this journey that we embark on. People found out about my story, and again, they offered me help. The most important part of it was really just moral support, because I wasn't getting that from my family at all, right? It took me 5 years to graduate from a 2.5-year program because I had no money and I had to work. I took a lot of semesters off. Gave my parents 6 months' notice of my graduation, thinking that for Latinos, that's enough time to, you know, give away the dog, make some tacos, put some gas in the car. And unfortunately, my parents did not show up, man. That hurt. That really hurt bad. I thought it was a big deal. Well, apparently they didn't. And it hurt. Because whether we like it or not, what our family's opinion is of our success or lack of success or whatever it is that it's important to us, their opinion counts. I mean, we can lie to ourselves and say that it doesn't, but it really does. And boy, did this one hurt bad. It was horrible. But I thought, you know what? I have my degree. I went to this great school. I know how to draw and paint really well. I'm going to be rich and famous. You know, the hell with them, right? Well, that's not how it works. Because unfortunately, I still looked at myself in the mirror, and I can honestly tell you that I did not like myself. Specifically because I realized that I had this huge list of deficiencies. I had no idea what culture was about. I had no self-esteem. I was completely shy, didn't want to talk, had no money, had no social skills, had no communication skills, and I had no educational support. And I thought, wow, I'm in big trouble, man, because I don't like this guy and I'm stuck with him. And what am I going to do, man? I can't just leave this guy, right? Luckily for me, I was introduced to a thing called books. I'm sure you've heard of them. For those of you who don't like reading books, first of all, I feel sorry for you. Second of all, if you truly want to make a big, huge dent in your life, like Mulder and Scully said, the truth is out there and it's in the books, guys. It is in the books. And I'm talking about specific books, because one of the biggest problems that we have currently today is that we have a lot of people trying to pass off opinions as facts. You know, opinions now have sometimes even more believability than facts do. And that is going to get us into huge trouble as a society. But I read these books, and I was given a second chance, an opportunity to look at myself from a different perspective, kind of like an out-of-body experience. And I realized, yeah, I grew up in this crazy family, had all these crazy experiences, but all experiences are important because I learned from that stuff. I'm important because there's a lot of people say that I'm important. I'm saying you're important too, right? And it was through these wonderful passages, you know, from Baldwin and from Anaya and Virginia Woolf, you know, that I was almost in tears because of the connection that I made with these words and these visual imagery that I could literally see and taste. It was a magical experience. So if I say anything that has any value to you, for you today, this evening, I'm intelligent, but I'm just basically taking a compilation of information and made it my own, pretty much. And it's all come from reading stuff, reading books and articles and having conversations. It was the late, great Francis Bacon who said, it's a sad fate for man to die too well known to everybody else and still unknown to himself or herself. I want to remind you that we're currently living in a society, unfortunately, that is still more interested in whether or not the Kardashians get robbed, right? Movie stars, sports players. Most people in our society today are more interested in knowing about everybody else than about knowing about themselves. And I'm telling you here that one of the big things that I've learned about my education is that one of the greatest things that can happen to you in that thing called education is to get to a point in your life where you look at yourself in the mirror and you like who you see. You like who you are. You're comfortable in your own skin and you don't want to be anybody else. I've gotten to the point where I like who Simon Silva is. I find Simon Silva to be interesting. And then we ask ourselves that very important question, what other abilities do I have? And I want to know, right? I want to know. You should want to know what other abilities you have. You should want to know more about yourself, not about anybody else, but learn about yourself. That's a great education. And we're going to learn about ourselves and find these hidden key pieces of ourselves in the multitude of experiences that we have, right? In these creative experiences. That's very important. But we need to clarify all of this peripheral stuff that is engaged and is part of the whole creative process and stuff that people are really not respecting as much as they should. In California, they have this whole thing called Common Core in education. They have arts integration, but I still think that a lot of people are confused as to what art is, what it's not, what creativity is. So I want to define some of those key components for you this evening. But I want to start with what is art? And again, these are just my opinions. Being in the field for over 25 years. What is art, according to Simon Silva? Well, I believe art is a way of life. I believe that art is an experience, it's a journey. I believe that art is a unique universal language. I get emails from people all over the world. I don't have to explain to them what I'm trying to say with this imagery, right? And if we smarten up as a society, we're gonna give creative types, visual artists, a degree, some recognition in the fact that they're actually creating a very unique universal language. The Hidden Brain, which is a book that I want to recommend to you guys, but The Hidden Brain does not understand language. It only understands visual imagery, nothing else. That's how they sell us stuff, guys. Art is about communication. Art is something that can take us to a place where we need to go. What do I mean by that? Well, if you ever have the luxury, or if you ever give yourself the luxury of sitting down and reading a novel, maybe War and Peace, right? Maybe not. To sit down and listen to a great symphony, a great jazz album, watch a great movie, experience a great piece of artwork. And after that experience, if you felt a little more complete, like you knew yourself just a little bit better, that is something only the arts can do for you. The one way that you can develop and get to a point where you understand yourself better and appreciate yourself better is that you need to seek yourself out. And the better you, the creative you, the more interesting you is out there to be found. You need to collect all those pieces to make it fit and make it make sense to you because we've been lied to. Friends, families, teachers, television, movies, books. So it's important for you to collect those pieces about yourself that's going to complete yourself, right? Art is about problem solving. Art is about inspiration. Art is about asking questions or answering questions and asking questions. Art is something that can that can make us more human. Now, this is a good one. Art is about giving voice to the ignored. That's a great one. I would say the most important one, right? Because think about this. Through a song, through a movie, through a painting, through a novel, everyone on the planet becomes important. Even stay-home moms, right? Who cares about stay-home moms? I do. Most important thing right now, right? Stay-home moms. So art produces that ground platform for everyone to become important. And we're all important. That's a fact. Art is about respect. A lot of people miss that. Art is about making good decisions. Art is trying to explain the unexplainable. Sometimes words just don't cut it. Art is a way to develop our sense of purpose and our sense of direction. So it's not about the pretty pictures, guys. So much more than that. It's not about weirding people out or making people uncomfortable. Yeah, is it art? Of course it's art. But just in the same way that I can stand up here and say only four-letter words, it's communication, but it's a very low-level communication, right? This is a photograph of my kids. Two of them are still single, ladies. In case you're interested, we can talk after the show, right? I'm going to do a show called Pimping My Kids, right? The one that's shorter is not that short. He's actually on his knees. I don't know why they did a recreating a picture over the years. When my wife and I got married, my wife had this really crazy idea that she wanted to have 6 or 8 kids. And I laughed, and I looked at her, and I said, "You're crazy. You're not going to have 6 kids with me. I don't know who you're going to have with, but not with me. I just want, like, a half of one, Ron. One that stays about this tall. That's it. That's all I want, right? Doesn't eat much. Doesn't grow much. And we can shop in the children's section forever, right? Well, I did the math, right? And I found out that these guys were all conceived in May because Latinas get 2 Mother's Days here in America. I mean, it's not that big of a deal, but I mean, 2 is better than 1, right? You deserve more like 100, right? But 2 is more than 1. And then I found out that, then I realized that her birthday is also in May. So, you know, you add a little bit of nice Pinot Grigio or some Pinot Noir. Yeah, you end up with 3 kids, right? And I couldn't wait to be part of my kids' education. My parents weren't part of mine. And I couldn't wait to ask them that very important question that many of us as parents, as adults, have done. By the way, it's not a good question. The question is, what do you want to be when you grow up? Many of you, if you're not thinking outside the box, you're probably saying, this guy's crazy. What's wrong with that? A lot. A lot is wrong with that. And I'll tell you why. We've compartmentalized all these professions, right? If you're an artist, you can't be, you know, a doctor. If you're a teacher, you can't be an artist. If you're an engineer, you can't be an artist. I went to one of the other schools. Can I mention the other college? Texas A&M? Can I? What is it? A&M University? What is it? Maybe not, right? Anyways, I went to one of those schools down there, and they had an art show. They invited me to come out. I did a presentation out there for one of the conferences. And they had an open art show, and some of the best artwork were actually coming from the engineers, not even from the art majors. Sure, why not? Okay? If you're a dentist, you can't be an author. You know, I mean, everything is compartmentalized, which is crazy. So I have to ask the question, guys. I don't know if you ask yourself this question, but I've asked myself this question a lot. Who came up with the dumb rule that you can only major in one thing, or you should only be one thing, and you should not even look the other way to possibly do something else and do it very well? Anybody know who made up that dumb rule? But I need to point it out to you guys, because I'm here to tell you that all of you guys are gifted in many, many things. Many things. And you can do many things extremely well. Don't be fooled into thinking that you're only one-dimensional, right? You're not. You're multidimensional. So the question for the 21st century should be then, blowing their minds, right? How many things do you want to become? How many things do you want to be when you grow up? Would that make a difference? With all of us, all of our kids? First day of school. There's a book that I read that kind of got me in this track. It's a book called Multiple Intelligences by Howard Gardner. I read this book, and my wife is a teacher, and I said, honey, do you guys have this conversation with kids the first day of school? Simone, we don't have time to do that. We have so many other requirements, there's no way in the world we're going to talk to these kids. And I said, well, wait a minute. Would it make a difference if the first day of school, you stood up there as a teacher, and you told these kids, you're in school, and I'm here as your instructor to help you find out all the gifts, all the intelligence that you have. And we do that every year, first day of school, from kindergarten all the way up to high school. Would that make a difference? I can tell you that in my life personally, it would have made a whole hell of a lot of difference. What? Wait a minute. You're telling me that I have more than one gift? And that all this is kind of like a treasure hunt? I'm going to be a pirate. I'm going to look for things, right? These hidden abilities? Are you kidding me? Wow, this is great. I want to come here. Oh, and I get to check out all the girls? Yeah, that's even better, right? Or the guys, right? It would make a huge difference. And unfortunately, the system itself is really kind of stuck on the old system. Yeah, you know, the education system is changing, but we need to change it a lot more quicker for all our sake. So I have to ask this question. How many of you consider yourselves to be creative geniuses on 10/27/2016? Any of you? You don't have to raise your hand, but just think about that for a second. Because usually when I ask this question, I usually get about a 10 to 15%, you know, raising of hands. But the truth is that all of you guys are creative geniuses, and I'll prove it to you guys. At night, when we fall asleep, we do a lot of things, right? Saliva runs down our face. We make all kinds of weird noises, right? My wife sounds like a lion, a tiger, and a bear, right? She says, so do I, but I think she's lying. I don't think it's true. But on average, the scientists believe that on average, the average person has anywhere from 3 to 5 dreams every single night. Some scientists believe that it's upwards of 7 to 9. And I want to remind you guys that a dream is like a movie, right? Yeah, fragmented, weird, strange. 1 minute I'm having dinner with Selma Hayek, romantic dinner. And then my wife enters the picture with a big, huge knife, right? So I have to fly away, right? Postpone my dinner with Selma Hayek, which is highly disappointing, right? I got to remind you guys that in our dreams, we are able to create dead people, famous people, friends, family. We're able to control the whole dialogue, and we kind of pretend that we don't even know what the other people in our dream are going to say, even though we're the ones that are in control of it, right? We think that we talk in our dreams, but we actually don't. We control the sights, the sounds, the weather, maybe even the smells. And we do this while we're asleep. Now, I don't know about you, but I think that's just pure genius. Pure genius. And it's not just a few of you guys that do this, right? It's all of us. We all dream. Now, whether you remember your dreams or not, that's a whole nother story. But the fact is that we all dream, and we're all geniuses within that world. The real question is, why are we able to do that while we're asleep, but we're not able to do that while we're awake? Now, that's the question, right? The million-dollar question. Something is going on there, and I believe that it centers around the whole idea of fear and criticism that we received over the years. Again, from family, friends, enemies, teachers, you name it. So the fact is that we're all geniuses, creative geniuses. The problem is that when I was going to school, the word genius was reserved only for the people in mathematics and science. Right? Those of us who are a little older can remember that. That was the only segment of the education system that actually deserved the word or the title genius. But of course, now we know that when we look at a good definition of what a genius is, we're actually going to find out that it's actually exceptional intellectual or creative power, or, check this out, other natural ability, and that can be a lot of different things, right? Unfortunately, I also believe that we're stuck in this idea that the word genius has to reveal itself in some sort of tangible way. We have to be able to see it, smell it, taste it, feel it somehow. And that's not true. That's not true at all. I think creativity and the genius of creativity could just be a concept. It could be an idea that is not tangible. And we do it all the time. But we kind of lose track, or we don't write it down, right? And we lose track of the genius that we really are. So we're going to find this creativity, this genius in a child, in their creativity, individuality, and more importantly, in the improvisation. That's key for indispensability in the 21st century. My family and I, we only watch basically two channels. We watch the Food Channel, which is the only channel that matters as far as I'm concerned, and National Geographic, right? For the most part. And I can tell you that we love to eat. I mean, we really love to eat. We're foodies, right? So we take these like trips on Saturdays down to LA, and we eat like the top three pizzas in LA, you know, that kind of stuff. You know, top three pork bellies in LA, you know, that kind of stuff. You know? We do that all the time, and yeah, it's great. So my kids love to cook. I love to cook too. And my kids, basically, when we don't have the right ingredients, what do? They improvise. That's going to be a skill for the 21st century, which employers are actually looking for. Improvisation, right? What does that mean? Well, don't worry if you don't know what that means, okay? I'm going to explain it to you. If you go to a Chinese restaurant, right, they serve you these chopsticks, just carry a pair around, right? And if you go to a Chinese restaurant, you see a kid that's screaming, ask the parents if you can give them the chopsticks, right? Watch what that kid's going to do with the chopsticks. They're going to split them in half, poke themselves in the eye, you in the eye, or their parents in the eyes, and then they're going to play the drums, they're going to play a violin, beautiful violin, by the way, and then they're going to dip it into that wonderful magic ink in front of them called water, and they're going to draw this beautiful image right in front of them. That's improvisation, right? Beautiful thing to watch. So we have to look at the things that don't exist or didn't exist in our brains when we were kids. Things that don't exist in a child's mind: perspective, failure, doubt, space, time, limitations, messes, rules, mistakes, criticism. Time. No time, right? Have you ever taken a trip with a kid? The kid keeps repeating, "Are we there yet? Are we there yet?" You know, that whole cliche in the movies? They don't have a sense of time. And what is the one thing that we battle against as adults? Lack of time, right? Can you imagine going back to a time where there is no time? That sounds pretty delicious to me, right? So what are the things that do exist in a child's mind? Well, improvisation galore, individuality, creativity, color, freedom, imagination, curiosity, and pretending. Oftentimes when I travel, I go to different school districts, and one of the questions that's repetitive all the time that the kids ask, that they want to know, is, "Mr. Silva, when did you become a professional whatever?" And they bought into this idea that a professional is simply someone who is older than 50, who's in a suit and tie, and has a degree. You know, when we were kids, and we found out that Sharpies, crayons, and markers could create this beautiful image on our parents' wall without permission, we had full confidence that that drawing, right, was going to make our house look so much better, right? So my definition of what a professional simply is a professional is someone simply that has full confidence in their abilities. Does that make sense? A professional is someone who has full confidence in their abilities. When a football player shoots that three, right, they're probably going to make it, well, depending who it is, but, you know, 9 times out of 10, right, or 10 times out of 10. Just full confidence in their abilities. That's what a professional is. It's not an adult. It could be simply a child, and I'll prove it to you guys. This is a drawing that my son did at age 6. This is what happens when, as parents, you show them all 15 Rocky movies and you introduce them to Elvis music, right? If Elvis and Rocky ever had a kid, this is what it looked like, right? But I want to direct your attention to the simple fact that he drew this with a black Sharpie and a yellow marker. Who does that? Who does that? A professional, right? Someone who has full confidence in his or her abilities. Can a child be a professional? You bet they can. You bet they can. But we don't think about these things. I submitted his artwork to professional art shows since he was 6 years old. If he would have won, you guys probably would have seen me on the 10 o'clock news being arrested, right? How can a child 6 years old compete with somebody who's 40 or 50? Is that legal? Is that crazy? Or is that all the above? He's a professional. This stuff was so much better than some of those artists that I've seen, right? And then he does this crazy piece where he signs his name across the whole entire painting. Who does that? So I thought, you know what? I need to do that. I need to sign a painting with my name across the whole thing, right? And I could not do it because I was terrified of ruining the painting. So you know what I did? I started the painting by signing the entire painting and then painting on top of it because I didn't want to ruin it with my signature. This is how much confidence my kid has or had at 6 years old. But then many of you are thinking, well, yeah, Mr. Silva, but, you know, genetically, of course, your kids are going to be fantastic because, you know, he's your kid. No, that's wrong, right? I come across kids who are phenomenal. These are some kids that I worked with this past summer in Palm Springs, right? There's a whole story behind the beaver. I'll tell you if we have time. But these are some kids that I work with, and this stuff is phenomenal. It's amazing. And then I tried doing my own beaver painting, and I failed, right? I mean, it's okay, but it's not as good as this stuff, right? I mean, it's okay. I need to practice a little bit more, right? So what is creativity? Because this has become a word that's almost politically energized. A lot of politicians are using it. A lot of people are using it in business. But, I mean, what are they really talking about here? And I really believe that a lot of people really don't even know what this word is about. So I'm going to give you some insight. Number one, I want to share with you guys what Albert Einstein said about this. He said that a society's competitive advantage will come not from how well its schools teach multiplication and periodic tables, but on how well they stimulate imagination and creativity. You do know that our education system is not the best in the world, right? I mean, I'm not talking about college, university. I'm talking about elementary, junior high, high school. I mean, go figure out where we're at. I don't even think we're in the top 10. I don't even think we're in the top 20. I could be wrong, but I haven't checked lately, but the last time I checked, I think we were like almost 30, somewhere around there. So what's going on? Well, you know, for a long time, we were determined that if we taught enough math and science that we were going to be competitive, that, you know, we were going to increase in the numbers. And now we're doing a thing called STEAM, right? They've added the art component. You know, I don't know if they're trying to be cute or what, right? Here's the thing, guys. It's pretty much the same thing, but in a different format. And don't get me wrong, I love technology, and I think technology is definitely the future. How many of you remember the movie that came out a number of years back called The Life of Pi, the one with the tiger? Do you guys know what the whole controversy about the movie was? When that movie came out in the Academy Awards, there was a huge, huge demonstration at the Academy Awards. And the reason why there was a huge demonstration was because Hollywood decided that they were paying the special effects artists way too much money. And why are they going to pay a guy, you know, $200 an hour to do special effects if they can do somebody in China, have somebody in China or Spain or Mexico or, you know, India, if they can pay them, I don't know, 2 cents an hour? I don't know what they pay them, right? So that's what they did. Most of the special effects in that movie was actually sent overseas, and a lot of people in Hollywood lost their jobs. So here's my question. If we teach all of our students how to do apps to be proficient technology-wise, what's going to prevent them from, you know, getting a job and then their job is going to be stripped away by sending all that work overseas? Is that possible? So what is the one thing that we can offer our future students, offer you, that is going to make you indispensable, it's going to make you valuable in the 21st century job market? Number one, I say that it's individuality and nurturing your creativity that's going to make you an individual, not like everybody else. Because how can you fire Steve Jobs, right? You can't. Well, number one, he's dead, but I mean, when he was alive, he is the company. You need to be the company. You need to be that person that to go to, the one that has all these creative ideas. You know, anybody can get in front of a keyboard, right? Start doing these apps. I mean, I don't know about anybody, but I mean, eventually it's going to be common ground, right? Just like everybody and their grandmother thinks they can do design now, right? Because of all these applications in these programs. So creativity, what is he talking about, creativity? Well, I think creativity, a good example of this is growing up, we didn't have a lot of money, so we had to come up with our own games and toys. So my parents would go out and buy something that came in a box about this size. They removed the contents for my parents back then, and a lot of parents and a lot of adults today with a lot of education. For them, this cardboard box is simply a piece of trash, right? It has no value, it has no significance. Why do they think it's a piece of trash? Because they don't have that sensibility that we all had, that they all had as kids, right? For us, it wasn't a cardboard box, it was an opportunity to apply 10, 15, 20, 30, 50 different applications, creative applications. Can you imagine how much our society and the world would change if we continue to embrace and nurture that sensibility that we all had as kids? Would it make a difference? I've had 28 doctors since I've had healthcare insurance. I can tell you that only four of them were actually helping me. I've dealt with some really horrible attorneys. So just because somebody is quote unquote a professional, it doesn't mean that they make our society better. Actually, sometimes they make it worse. And we have to be careful of that. So it's not a piece of trash. It's an opportunity. So we need to embrace that sensibility and bring it back to its importance the way it should be. So what is the truth about this whole creativity? Because if you go online now, you're going to find a lot of presenters, even on TED Talks, who are about 80% correct, maybe less, according to Simon Silva. I even heard one lady talking about how we need to go back to what the ancient Greeks believed, right? The ancient Greeks believed that inspiration for originality or creativity, if you want to call it that, came from the gods, and even invented heavenly creatures called the muses as supervisors of human creativity. I think that's dumb, for lack of a better word, right? It's ridiculous, okay? Number one, guys, let me tell you the truth of re-nurturing your creativity. Number one, it's going to be a lot of hard work. There is no magic pill. Now, I know a lot of you guys think that you can multitask, and I'm sure you can do just that, multitask. But studies have shown that you're probably not going to do as well if you focus on just one or two things, okay? So look into that. I'm just saying. A good example of this whole thing called hard work is Hemingway. I read this thing in this article that Hemingway wrote 47 different endings for the novel A Farewell to Arms before settling on the one he liked. I'm sure that when you guys are asked to do a report, you guys do 47 different versions, right? Yeah, and you laugh, right? Because you know I'm kidding. 47 different endings. Because the real question is this, guys. How do we know that the second, the third, the fourth, or the fifth, or the 12th, or the 20th, or in this case, the 47th version, how do we know if the 47th version isn't going to be amazing? How do we know? Well, the only way that we're going to know is to actually do what? To do it. There is no magic pill. It's a lot of hard work. So what's the other truth about nurturing your creativity? Well, the other thing is that you have to saturate your mind with inspirational or motivational material. And no, The Last Jurassic Park doesn't count. That's gonna hurt your brain, hurt your creativity. There's nothing creative about that, okay? I'm talking about stuff that gets you out of the box. I mean, if you can listen to Pedro Infante and Mozart, you know, in the same hour, I mean, you're on the money, guys, right? If you can listen to Bill Evans, right? And if you can listen to Rage Against the Machine at the same time, you're on the dime, right? You're on the right track. It's all good stuff, all good stuff. Unfortunately, I don't think I sent the suggestion list, but if you guys remind me, I don't know if it's Maria or anybody else, remind me to send you the list of books and music and movies that I highly recommend. As a matter of fact, I can do it after the presentation. But here's the other thing. I think that we've also created these monsters, right? I took my kids to go see Bob Dylan at the Shrine Auditorium a couple of months back. We actually walked out of the concert. Why? Well, because according to the LA Times, and I agree with them, Bob Dylan decided to be the artist and not the performer. So he sang a lot of stuff that we just didn't necessarily like. You know, with the political climate that it is, I was hoping that he was going to, you know, sink his teeth into it, you know, really just make some comments, say something, motivate me. And boy, were my kids disappointed in Bob Dylan. Boy, was I disappointed in the amount of money that I wasted on that, right? Boy, that was crazy. Now, am I saying that Bob Dylan isn't this creative genius? No, I'm not saying that at all. I think Bob Dylan is amazing, right? I think Paul McCartney is amazing, but I think Paul McCartney should have retired, you know, 20 years ago, you know, after Wings. But here's the interesting thing, though. I think that we have a tendency to kind of believe that a lot of people are head and shoulders about everybody else. And that may be true. I'm not saying that they're not. But I think the problem is that I think people still are in this, they have this notion that, you know, the origins of a creative idea or creative whatever is so mysterious that it can only happen to a very select few people. And I'm telling you that personally, I'm not that creative. I mean, I'm creative, but it's not a mystery. I mean, there's rhyme and reason to this whole creative process. And I'm going to explain what happens, how this thing happens. It's not magic. It doesn't fall from the skies as we once thought at all. There's some practicality behind it. These creative ideas, we bring them to life because we plant a seed. A presentation, a book, a movie, an album, a conversation, you know, something of that nature. We plant a seed, and anytime you plant a seed, you got to do what? You got to water it, you got to feed it, you got to nurture it. And if you don't do that, it's going to do what? It's going to die. How long is that gestation period? I have no idea. Could be 2 days, it could be 2 years, it could be 10 years as far as I'm concerned. I don't know. How is it going to reveal itself? How are we going to give birth to that? And how is it going to reveal itself? I have no idea. I don't know. All I can tell you is that we do plant a seed, and it's not magic. But when it happens, it has this appearance of being magical in nature, because we've been carrying it around, kind of like a pregnant woman with a baby, right? But then we give birth to that. But in creative aspects, you know, we don't know when it's going to happen, how it's going to happen, and how it's going to reveal itself. And that's the beautiful nature of this whole creative process, that we give birth to that, but we don't know how it's going to reveal itself. We don't know if it's going to be a boy or a girl or triplets or twins or whatever it is, right? But it's a beautiful thing to plant that seed, to nurture it, and to give birth to it, right? To give life to it. One of the things that we need to also do is we need to nurture that whole curiosity, which we had in abundance as children. And it was Albert Einstein who said it best. He said, "I have no special talents. I am only passionately curious." I once asked a woman if she was pregnant. I will never ask that question again, because she wasn't, right? I don't have any special talents, guys. I'm just passionately curious. I'm curious. Do you guys know if fish drink water? Yes or no? Look it up. I wanted to know. Do fish drink water? It's a good question. The curiosity, I come across kids as young as second grade who no longer have any kind of curiosity about anything. And when your curiosity goes, your learning is going to go with it. The same thing with asking questions. If you don't ask questions, your learning is going to cease to kind of move forward, right? I'm not going to share that because I don't want to embarrass my kid, but I want to share with you guys the differences between talent and creativity, because there's a lot of confusion as to what talent is and what creativity is, and they're not the same thing. They can coexist in the same area, but not necessarily, right? I have a lot of friends who are artists who are very talented, but they're not very creative, okay? So let's take a look at four questions and focus in on the unique voice, unique perspective, or unexpected or fresh. And I'm going to show you some award-winning high school artwork. In high school, my artwork looked just like this. Is this talent? Is it creativity? Or is it both? I'll let you decide. Personally, I think that it's purely talent. I know for a fact that if I had enough time with all of you guys, I can teach you how to draw and paint better than this. I know that for a fact. For a fact. So, we're still on the hunt. What is creativity, right? Well, let's take a look at these four questions again. Again, focus on unique voice, unique perspective, unexpected or fresh. But this time I'm going to show you some children's artwork. Who draws a horse with five legs? This little girl does, right? And because I know design and I know composition, I can tell you that that image of the mice up there with a tail that is like 3 miles long is absolutely exquisite. I want to know who these kids are. I want to hire them. I want to buy their art. I want to know who they are. These guys, for all I know, it's the same person that did all the artwork. I don't know. It's talent. These guys, I think it's talent, I think it's creativity, and a lot of individuality. I want to hire these guys. I want to know who they are, okay? So why is it important to teach creativity in the 21st century? Well, this recent study that was done by IBM, CEOs now consider creativity to be now the most important leadership quality for success in business, outweighing even integrity. That's a mouthful, right? So this is some serious stuff. It was the guy by the name of Ellis Paul Torrance. He's considered to be the father of creativity. Back in the, I believe it was the 60s, I believe, he did a study. But check out what he says. He says, know, understand, take pride in, practice, develop, exploit, and enjoy your greatest strengths. How are we going to know what our greatest strengths are if we're not moving forward on that? He created a really simple but very dynamic test that he did with a lot of children. He would take a toy and he would ask them a very simple but very profound question. How can we make this better? How can we make it more fun, entertaining? And I tell you, I cringe at all the things that need to be made better in our society. A lot of stuff, okay? But why is this important? Well, he found out that those who came up with more good ideas than the Torrance task grew up to be entrepreneurs, inventors, college presidents, authors, doctors, diplomats, and software developers. Not that I'm saying that those are the most important careers. That's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying a lot of people respect that. But it was Jonathan Plucker of the University of Indiana who recently reanalyzed the Torrance data, and the correlation of lifetime creative accomplishment was more than 3 times stronger for childhood creativity than childhood IQ. I think that's really important. But this is the list that I've compiled in terms of benefits of cultivating a creative mind. And I'm using myself as an example. Again, I'm not the example, but I'm just an example of how I benefited from cultivating a creative mind. I will guarantee you that it will develop better problem-solving skills, communication skills, multiple solutions, self-esteem, decision-making skills, listening skills, lifelong learning, the ability to ask questions, better questions. The ability to be insightful, personal awareness, abstract thinking, critical thinking, and it helps find a multitude of many hidden abilities and skills. Now let's take a closer look at two of these. When I say that it develops better problem-solving skills, I believe that the essence of all creativity is about problem-solving. We're inspired by something, and it produces a need to express or share what we see or what we feel, and this becomes a problem that needs to be solved. And we solve the problem through a painting, a song, a dance, a story, or through words that best captures the essence of our idea. But take a look at this one. It develops better communicators, or better communication skills, right? We become better communicators when we're able to explain, communicate what we think, how we think, and how we see, and what we see. Someone asked me at a recent conference if I've always been this intelligent. And boy, did I want to slap that guy silly, right? How dare you, right? My big ego is talking. But I wanted to answer him honestly, and I looked back and I looked at Simon Silva 1.0, and I saw this kid in junior high, elementary school, with a lot of hopes, dreams, a lot of ideas, incredibly brilliant. But just like all of you, some of you, most of you, I don't know, I didn't have the appropriate communication skills to show the world how brilliant it was in my environment here. But now I can, right? The only way that you're going to show me, show your professor, show the world that you're extremely brilliant is that you're going to have to communicate it somehow. We're all brilliant, but we need the communication skills in order to show and prove to the world. And this, again, could come through a painting, a drawing, a story, a speech. You never know, right? It develops multiple solutions. We develop an ability to create multiple solutions when we develop multiple designs or sketches. One of the great things about, you know, going to art school is that we were forced to do a multitude of sketches and ideas. I thought they were just trying to make me quit, but it wasn't about that. It was, they were trying to create second nature of thinking, right? Who are we gonna hire? Somebody who has the ability to come up with one or two ideas? Or someone who is capable of being able on the fly to be able to come up with 6 or 12 ideas? You choose. I choose more ideas, right? So this is something that we can definitely practice and get us to that point. Individuality, of course, in the 21st century is gonna be critical, and it has been, right? But it's gonna be even more critical. When I work with adults, because we've been conditioned to wanna please the teachers or the professors in front of us in our classes, because they're gonna hand out the grades, right? When I work with adults, they wanna satisfy me. So if I ask them to draw me a fish, they're gonna draw a fish like the one at the top. Boring. If I ask a kid to draw me a fish, do you think kids care what I want? They don't care what I want, right? They could care less. Because their individuality is still intact. Now, do we have individuality here? That's the key component, right? It's a serious question. To me, the answer is no. Do we have individuality here? Absolutely, right? In abundance. Do we have individuality here? Absolutely. Here's another kid. I think he's like 8 years old doing this stuff. Just amazes me, right? Friend of mine's kid. Education, we know, is going to be critical in the 21st century. I got to remind you guys that my parents thought that someone who gets a degree, who is formally educated, becomes better than the rest of us. And I would remind you that in my world, education only makes us different. It doesn't make anybody better. It just makes us different. That's it. You don't have to be afraid of me, right? I'm not better than any of you. It was the great Will Durant who said, education is a progressive discovery of our own ignorance. Ouch. But it's true. It's really true. The more I learn, the more I realize how ignorant I am, right? So we need to change from this linear model of education into something much more organic and dynamic, right? It's kind of like a tree, right? We start at the bottom, but there's many ways to the top. And we don't have to just select one branch. We can go to many different ones. I'll leave you with this. Tony Wagner, if you haven't looked him up, please look him up. Tony Wagner, this amazing Harvard Innovation Education Fellow. He said something very important. He said, there's no competitive advantage today in knowing more than the person next to you. I started off with the story, right? Being in class and watching the same 5, 6 people answer all the questions. He's saying that nobody cares about that. How many questions you can answer? Because we walk around with these things called cell phones, which is basically a computer. You can ask me anything you want, and I can look up an answer, right, for you. It may not be the correct answer, but it's an answer. I didn't grow up with the internet. The problem that you guys are going to have is filtering all the garbage that's out there that's not true at all. That's going to be tough, guys. So he's saying that if you have the answers to all this stuff, it doesn't matter. It's no longer a competitive advantage. He's saying that the world doesn't care what you know. He's saying that what the world cares about is, what are you going to do with what you do know? And to me, that sounds a lot like improvisation and this wonderful creative sensibility, because to me, intelligence is combining things that don't normally go together or not normally put together by someone else, right? Kind of leads me back to that whole cardboard box theory, right? As kids, as children, we didn't know a lot. But we could do more with this box than our own parents with education could do with this box, right? So the real game here, guys, is to produce this creative mind, to nurture this creative mind, to be more apt to be improvisers, to improvise, and to be creative, to come up with those solutions. And we're going to find, again, we're going to find this creativity. We're going to find ourselves in these key pieces of ourselves in the creative experiences, because it all boils down to variable experiences. There's no way in the world that I would have been able to create the Gotham Jazz series, right? If I didn't know jazz was amazing. If I didn't know comic books existed. You have to have those tools, you have to have those experience in order for you to have the ability to combine those things and create something very unique and different. Variable experiences is the key. And if all your friends are white, if all your friends are black or Latino, I can hook you up with some variety of different people, right? You need variety in your life. You know, you can learn from other cultures, we can learn from other cultures, we can learn from other genders, right? We can learn from other individuals. That's super important to mix it up because we all bring something very unique and different to the table. All of you guys bring something very unique and different to the table. So it's all about variable experiences. So what have I learned? Well, I can tell you that at 55, I've learned that if we limit our variable experiences, we're going to limit our education. If we limit our education, we're going to limit our personal growth. And if we limit our personal growth, we're going to limit our potential and effectiveness as parents, students, inventors, you name it. But I have a warning, guys. We can produce these amazing generation of super smart, creative individuals, but you know, I thought we were done with this nonsense back in the 60s, man. Terrible nonsense, right? Obviously, we haven't learned our lesson. We can produce these wonderful generations of very intelligent, creative individuals, but if you have no respect and compassion and love for other individuals, we're going backwards, guys. We're not going forward. We're going backwards. So put a little bit of respect and compassion and love for everybody in your life, guys, even if you don't know them, right? Because we need a lot more of that in the days that we're living in. All right. I know that's a lot of information to digest, but I wanted to be very thorough, and I want to open it up for questions. Any questions or comments that you have? I would love to answer anything you want me to answer at this point. Questions, comments, money you want to give me, that's good too. Yes, you have a question.
If you had one thing to change in your life, what would you change?
I wouldn't have asked Bertha Medina to be my girlfriend. Boy, she broke my heart, right? Those first ones, they really hurt. They still hurt. Boy, is she embarrassed now, right? She could have had me, right? I'm serious about that. In the bigger picture, what would I have changed? You know, I once started writing this story because I'm currently writing a couple of books and writing some screenplays and doing a children's book. And like, I don't have enough to do. I'm still coming up with other creative projects, but I started writing this story called I Could Have Been a Contender. You know, who would have Simon Silva had been if he would have had parents like me that would have encouraged him, nurtured him, provided him with all kinds of experiences and materials? And I basically tore it up because, honestly, I don't think I would change anything. I really wouldn't. You know, I did say Bertha Medina, and that's true. I wouldn't have asked her to be my girlfriend, right? But I don't think I would change anything. At this point, I mean, I wouldn't want to re-experience a lot of the stuff that I went through, but all of those experiences, for whatever they were worth, for however harsh they were, created Simon Silva. And that's a good thing, I think, right? So honestly, I wouldn't change anything. I really wouldn't. I really wouldn't. I probably wouldn't have spent those $500 in Vegas, you know? I knew that the odds were against me. That's a big mistake, right? Yes. Yes.
What preceded that decision? What connection to art did you have from when you were a little bitty to 18?
Well, I think first of all, I think the art teacher that I had in high school, in school, he was a nice guy. He was a very nice guy. But I think he was a football coach teaching photography and art, and he didn't do a very good job. Let's put that. Sorry, Mr. Pittler. But I think that my perspective of what art was, I thought art was about copying things. You know, I thought art was about creating like a cover band. You know, I thought it was copying stuff. And although Miles Davis said that, you know, first we imitate and then we innovate, and I'm truly, you know, in agreement with that. I mean, you know, we got to produce something, and we're all motivated and inspired by someone or something. But I thought art was really about copying stuff. And so I was really good at that. You know, I mean, the only reason why I didn't get beat up in school was because the Cholos got these free pictures that I used to draw for them, right? Their car and their girlfriends. So I was hands-off from all the guys that wanted to beat me up, so that was a good thing. But I had no idea what art really was about. You know, I mean, I thought it was, you know, copying stuff. I thought it was kind of a weird, strange thing. Honestly, the only reason why I picked art was because I didn't know what I was doing. I really didn't. I figured that my best chance of success were going to be, I already knew how to draw and paint, so I figured, okay, I'm that much closer to, you know, being successful in that area. But if I had to do it all over again, and maybe that applies to your question, if I had to do it all over again, I would probably go into film, because I love film. And I'm currently writing 3 screenplays with my son, who is a film editor. I'm writing 3 screenplays, because I love movies. But I think that the visual arts is always going to be, you know, my number one love, right? But I was really confused. I didn't know what I was getting myself into, and it just was the safest thing for me to get into. I mean, that was the only reason I went into it. Anybody else? Yes. You know, I've had to train my brain to do that. You know how I see people right now is I don't have my cell phone on me, but anybody here own a iPhone? Not that I want to borrow it or anything, but when you connect it to a computer, it gives you a bar, right? And I was trying to figure out what's going on with our society because everybody seems to be using the same excuse. I'm busy. Well, we're all busy, right? And I don't think people can tell me they're busier than I am. I don't think so. I definitely would win some money on those bets. But I've had to train my brain to be very selective of what's important and what's not important. And I do it every day. And so I consume a lot of information, but I've trained my brain to be selective and to kind of go through it a lot quicker. I think that social media and I think the technology has kind of created this overwhelming presence in most people's lives. And most people are overwhelmed to the degree if you can look at that bar that you get when you connect your iPhone to the computer, you have a certain amount of memory that's being used by apps, photographs, video, and so forth, right? I think most people's brains, they have like 2 megabytes of free information and they're afraid to use that. I'm just generally speaking here, right? But I think that there is this kind of great dilemma where I think that people now have like 3 cell phones, right? They have a personal, a business, and I don't know, whatever else. And I find it hard for people to even get back to me in a timely manner. Every year in January, I go through my cell phone. I delete half of the contacts on my phone because I haven't heard from them, from these individuals, family, friends, member, business people. I haven't heard from them in 6 to 8 months. And their excuse is that they're busy. I mean, we're all busy. I mean, we're all overwhelmed, right? But I think that that flood of information is only going to get worse. And so I think it's very important for us to train our brains to process that information and go through it in a much more efficient manner. So how do I keep all this stuff? You know, I don't look at being creative as being work. You know, I look at it as being fun. So, I mean, how can you not respond to something that is creative and beautiful? I mean, you have to. By the way, you guys want to know how I know that something is really creative? Okay, here's my secret. I know something is super creative when I see something and it angers me that I wasn't the one that came up with that idea. See, you guys laugh because you know exactly what I'm talking about, right? It angers me that that should have been mine. That's how I know. All right, anybody else? Any other questions, comments? Yes. What artists inspire? Well, I think in the beginning, it really was a revelation for me, cultural revelation. I mean, I was the books that I was reading initially was, you know, the Rodolfo Naya, the Sandra Cisneros, Denise Chavez. I was reading those books. Now I read pretty much everything and anything, you know, because I kind of moved on. But culturally speaking, I guess, you know, a lot of the early Chicano artists were the ones that were really kind of motivation for me to kind of get into this stuff. Like I said in the presentation, 2 of my favorite artists now, and I think for a lot of artists, is basically Cezanne and Vincent van Gogh. So I love their stuff. And you know, my artwork is changing, it's evolving as I'm changing, evolving. A lot of people think that I don't paint anymore, but I actually do. It's just specifically for a lot of my collectors. I don't have, that's the problem. I don't have enough time to actually paint enough stuff to actually have an art show, which a lot of people have been asking me for. So there are some things that are being foregone, but I think, unfortunately, a lot of people have actually been very upset with me that I haven't painted enough. And that, you know, this whole thing about creativity is nonsense. You know, that I've embarked in this crazy journey of nothingness. I'm just repeating what I've been told, right? And yet, I think that I've sort of evolved where I've taken my studio from an actual physical place into my brain. You know, I think that a lot of the creativity is just thoughts and processes and things that I'm thinking about. You know, but unfortunately, some people aren't really appreciative of that, you know. So I'm doing what I enjoy right now. Anybody else? Comments, questions?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
She was so upset because she knew the difference between, and, you know, what, yes, that's an artist, but
sure.
This is what I want to do. Mm-hmm. I came here because my students are here, and I wanted to come and listen and hear what you had to say, but I've heard a lot of things that we can talk to our children about, and so I think one thing you can just thank you for your insights.
Thanks. Yeah. Have any of you seen this video? I just want to give you guys this. I'm not going to charge you guys for this part here. But, I tried to do this with my weenie dog. She wouldn't let me. So. This is amazing. I mean, this is amazing. Look at the dog. I'm surprised the dog even lets her do this. It's brilliant. Yeah. All right. So before I leave, any last comments, questions that I can answer? I was. Yeah. You know. Part of the thing that I do is I do the lecture part of it, or I do a keynote, and then we do an actual breakout session. Only because they're actually waiting for me to do another presentation for some Girl Scouts. You know, maybe in the future I can come back and we can actually do like an actual hands-on, because I do like a creativity workshop where you actually work on some projects. So this would be like the keynote lecture part of it, and then there's some actual hands-on stuff that I do with kids and stuff. But unfortunately, a lot of people think that it's just for art students, and it's not. I mean, this has nothing to do with art, really. It doesn't. One of the things that I find really fascinating is that when I do these workshops, a lot of people say, well, can I bring the kindergartners? And I say, the kindergartners are actually a requirement, because I sprinkle them around the classroom, because they're the ones that dictate the pace of the whole creative experience, you know, for the rest of them. They actually dictate what they should be doing, which is kind of interesting. All right, anybody else before I leave? Thanks again for coming out, guys.